Okay, everyone, welcome back. And we will continue this event with Anant and Anna Maria's presentation on mapping the landscape of quantum games. This was a project under Q-Intern 2021 program by Q-World, and they will present the outcomes of their project. Okay, you can take the lead.
Thanks a lot. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
And the screen's visible.
Yep.
Okay, perfect. So first of all, I'd like to thank the organizers of this talk to let us present our findings in this seminar. So hey, everyone, this is Amanand. I'm a first year undergraduate from India. And today here we'll be talking about, I and my co-presenter Anna Maria will be talking about the project that we did under the Q-Intern program, which was held from July to August in 2021. We would like to, under the mentorship of Zeki, and we would like to thank Q-World and Zeki for this amazing opportunity. Now, so let's talk about what we'll be talking about or like what we've done. So the entire project is divided into two parts, the first and the second part, which is the data gathering and the visualization, or under a larger domain, what we have actually done in the project up till now. That will be talked upon by me, and further followed by journal academia, future aspects, and a few quantum games, game jams, and hackathons will be talked about by my co-presenter Anna Maria. So let's get started. So let's start first of all by talking about data gathering, because quantum games were there's two parts to quantum games. Okay, few of them are very common, which everyone knows: quantum chess, cube pong, quantum tic-tac-toe. So for data gathering or collecting various other quantum games from different genres and compiling a perfect list of them, after a point, there were hindrances. We could not find quantum games. Like Google was exhausted in some sense. Random Googling was not helping us. So at that point, these two resources, the repository of quantum games by Mohanty and the documentation that was drafted by Laura Pips, so both of them helped us a lot. The repository had games, quantum games from back up to 2009 till 2020, I guess. And this documentation was indeed extremely helpful, because this documentation not just had quantum games, but it also has ideas. It had quite a lot of games which were, proposed. They went halfway, but due to some hindrances, they had to be stopped. So we used these two resources extensively, and Google for collecting all of the quantum games that we could find. So voila, we found out 118 quantum games from varying genres, and what's the purpose of the game, what can be done with the game, and why it was invented in the first place. So after this comes the hard part, that which we personally found out it was really hard. So classifying the quantum games we found. Now, as everyone in this meeting would know, there's no general metrics for a quantum game to, as you know, what part of the game that is built has to be quantum. Is it supposed to be coded in some quantum computing language like Qiskit-Circ, or like what part of the game is quantum? Over here, our journal and academia club helped us a lot. So yeah, just a big question, but how are we supposed to classify, because there's so many variables or so many metrics that can be considered. So with the help of the journal and academia club, we came up with these first four aspects on which we could think about for classification, and developed in a hackathon was another classification which we found during the searching of the game itself. So what platform on the quantum game can be played on? So is it available on Mac, Linux, Windows? So the larger area or the more platforms it is available on, the better reach it has. So more people can play it. Now download requirements of the game, whether the game is, you know, browser playable or it has to be downloaded compulsorily. Where are the files? Is it in a GitHub repo or it's a zip file which can be downloaded? The genre of the game, is it a simulation game? Is it a arcade puzzle? Is it meant for educational purposes? So what was the purpose? What's the genre of the game? Now, this one specific part is a counterpart in classical game available. Initially, anyone would think that a lot of quantum games would have been, you know, in some sense inspired or, you know, had some basic intuition which would be used in building up a quantum game, but the results which we found were not very, you know, to what one person would think about such a result. And lastly, we found out about these hackathons and quantum game jams, which was talked upon, like, you know, one of the hackathons was talked upon in the previous lecture. So the hackathons are generally very intuitive and a very good way to develop good quantum games, good playable quantum games. Generally, in these hackathons, what happens is the organizers, they give out a theme, which is generally a quantum mechanical phenomena or some metrics, or, you know, there's a criteria which has to be met. And then the developers or the participants are asked to develop a game upon it. And then, you know, the games are developed on it. So developed in a hackathon or not was a really big and a crucial question to basically understand that whether these hackathons or how productive these hackathons are. So let's go ahead. So these were the statistics which we found. Now, a lot of these games are totally free. Just, you know, we have a list. You can go to the website and you can play it. And is there a class? So these are the various genre of which these games belong to. So as you can see, 33% of the game belongs to the arcade genre, followed by puzzle, simulation, and then there are smaller subcategories. Now, just if you guys can clearly see, yeah, built-in and hackathon, yes. So more than 50%. So it's 118 was the total games which we found. So more than 53% of the games were built in these hackathons. Now, which is a really good number, and it motivates all of us around to participate and organize these hackathons. Now, this over here is an interesting result, as one would think that, you know, there's a classical intuition or classical reference to which the quantum game is being built upon, but that's not the case. More than 60% of these games were themselves unique. They had no classical counterpart, which means that the games that are currently being developed are themselves, you know, a part of their own creativity, and there's no relation of classical games on quantum games, which I found is very nice. People are creating really well. Next upon, we talk about, you know, we got the data, we classified it. Now, how do we showcase it to the people? How do we show it to everyone that it's something we've done? So for this, we built a website by ourselves from scratch. And this is how the website looks. I feel one of my co-presenters can paste the website in the chat. Now, the thing is, this website is complete, but there are a few key tweaks to be made. So there are not all the games available, but yes, our team is actively working towards it and we'll be finishing it soon. And apart from that, the entire data, if you could just go on the website, the entire list of games in a CSV format has been put up. So if any case the website doesn't work out for you, you can totally go to the CSV file and all of the 118 games will be available over there. Now, what about it? So in future, we plan to publish a comprehensive report of what we have found, what were the statistics that we found with the surveys which we held out. So the surveys, there were a series of surveys which we performed and rolled out forms for, which will be talked upon more by my co-presenter, and we'll be talking about it soon. So what's next? So from over here, my co-presenter takes on, and what she'll be talking about is the Journal and Academia Club. what are the future aspects of this project and a few more quantum game jams and hackathons.
Okay, so I'm going to share the screen so you can see it. Everything is all right.
Yes.
Okay. So hello, I'm Ana Maria, and I'm going to talk about the future part of the project. So for the discussion of the future, we had a journal club and academic background sessions. And as you can see, we discussed 5 papers, and I highlighted a few important words and concepts. So the first was the inclusive learning for quantum computing, supporting the use of quantum literacy. For the puzzle game Quantum Odyssey, then a guideline for game development-based learning, a literature review, then the design challenges for science games, then the fostering scientific inquiry with games, vision motivation and memorization, and then the effectiveness of educational games on scientific concepts acquisition. So if you have put attention, you have noted that there is a common topic, and maybe it can be more clear using the word cloud. So of course, the 2 more common words were the game and quantum, but we can also see here important words like learn, students, use, education, scientific method, and maybe it can be more clear using the 4 more common bigrams. So what we did was the discussion of educational games on the scientific concepts acquisition, in particular in quantum mechanics. So we have conclusions, and here I put some of them. So the first one was about the unguided situations, that unguided situations can be very useful to learn because the students should learn science by doing science. Then with unguided situations, they can use new concepts that can build on basic concepts that they have from before or that the same game has constructed. Then the games can increase motivation and attractiveness, but they should meaningfully integrate their learning and not just focus on one of the 2. And that collaboration can be very useful because the students can discuss their hypothesis and come to a conclusion for the part of the strategize and coordinate. And then that there is a lack of review literature on games guidelines, even when the guidelines proposals have been increasing. And the teaching of contextualization with narrative plus communication can show the communal and interactive nature of science. So this can show the entanglement of science and society, that it's very important. So now here are some more, maybe more general remarks. And here I'm paraphrasing teammate Amesh. So the desire of finding connections with everyday life can make quantum mechanics hard and can lead to misconceptions. And this difficulty of quantum mechanics can also be related to maths. So maths can be very difficult to give intuition and have trouble giving intuition, but quantum games can provide that intuition and can give new story, new environment, and new features, and then give the reinforcement learning that we could need. Then that games enhance understanding, and for example, it was shown by the game Quantum Odyssey. Okay, so we had a collection of information with this form, and so here are some examples of the questions that we asked. So have you ever played a quantum game? If you have, what is the reason? Which game did you play? What is your experience with the game? Then please order the following features of a game in order or importance to you. And would you be interested in taking part in playing out and reviewing in quantum games? So we have here some examples of the responses. So have you ever played a quantum game? Most people said no. And of the people that said yes, the majority said that it was for research and study purposes. So we learned that the general public doesn't know about quantum games, and this it was shown to in the responses to this question, what quantum games have you played or heard about? And it were mentioned that, yeah, quantum chess and some specific games, but a lot of the answers were never known. They haven't heard about quantum games. in the question, would you be interested in taking part in playing out and regraining quantum games? The vast majority of people suggest. So we have two extra forms about adding the names of the quantum games you know about, and then if you want to take part in the game reviewing process with the categories that Anand already mentioned, we have also to, we are going to share these later. Then a little note here, in the categorization part, we had to test the games. So this was one of them in particular, the game Beach Body Diet, and it was like a principal character had to eat these little monsters here, and the little monsters were generated by quantum random numbers, and it was a very pleasant to the eye, very nice game. And in the team, they had one programmer and four designer, artist, storyteller. And I mentioned this because of this last phrase. So having no quantum physicists in the team, we decided to make a game that uses existing tools provided by IBM, James Wooten. And then maybe the question here was, what if they had the quantum physicists in the team? So what concepts could they have used before beyond the quantum random numbers part? So maybe the point here is that if you have the opportunity to work with people from other disciplines, be it sciences or arts, you should take it because it can be a very interesting and enriching experience to everyone, and very good work could be done. So about the events part, we have the Quantum Game Hackathon. We are going to mention the Quantum Games Hackathon organized by Quantum Game Foundation with people and a Quantum Fight Club, that it was their first section of this event. And then the Internet Festival 2021, organized by Fondazione Sistema Toscana, that had a Quantum Game Jam last year. And yeah, we are going to put these links later. And then we wanted to show you how many people are working in game jams right now. This is the place in Chayo, this was last week. So it was a lot of people and a lot of opportunities on game jam right now. Okay, so about the future aspects of the project. So we have the writing and reporting part mentioned by my co-presenter a little before, and then the working and our website and updating it. And then we wanted to do a situated history of quantum games, an interactive map in which we could use the information that we already collected. And this could be based in a situated history of atomic models that was presented by researchers of the Georgia Institute of Technology. Then the talks and podcasts with creators of quantum games, and then some collaborations with some candidates we have in mind. And then two quotes that I think are relevant to the project. So by James Wooten, what can quantum computers do for games is an important question for the game industry, but also what can games do for quantum computers? And by Simone Weil, the joy of learning is as indispensable in study as it is to running. So this is an invitation not just to use quantum games, but to think about new and creative ways of teaching and learning. And here is the team. So here is Yudei, Amesh, Anand, Ana Maria, Hitanshu, Heidi, and Ezra, and our mentor, Seki Sestier. And here are the countries in which we are, that are Canada, Colombia, Turkey, and India. And by last, we had a twin project also directed by Seki Sestier. That it was called Mapping the Landscape of Quantum Education. So they had a lot of resources. It's a repository of educational resources. So we are going also to share the link. And also they have a YouTube channel in which they have playlists also with resources. So we wanted to mention that. And that was all. Thank you. You have our information here in case you want to write to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ana Maria. It was a really nice presentation. And okay, do you have questions our participants.
Let me just keep sharing. So we are going. Oh, okay. So I'm posting to get links and.
Okay, I can ask a question. Let me find the website. If I remember it correctly, Anand said something for the CSV file that people can access it. Is it true, or how can they do this?
Yeah, so just a minute. Can I share my screen again?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, and one of the questions, okay, so the question we have is where will the list of the 118 quantum games you found be available? That is similar to my question. That is, how can people access this list?
So I guess everyone can see my screen now.
Yeah.
So if you go to the website, this is how the website looks. Now, I was working on the website as a part of the full stack team. Now, this is what we have been up to. This is how the website would entirely went. It's just that we cannot import all the games to the website itself. So this is how the website looks for now. So if you guys want to access all the games, all that you have to do is you want to go to Classify. And over here is the link to the entire list of games which we found. And it's on just reading access. So if you go over here, like let's just say anyone of you wants to play some game. And you just go to this link. Over here, this is an article, and when you go down, there's a link to the game.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, so that's all of the games can be found.
Yeah, and also, as both Anant and Anna Maria mentioned in the presentation, if you want to add certain games, we would be happy that you do. Because this was a 2 months long project, and after the project, we will try to continue this, but it would be much easier with the community support to keep this list kind of active. Okay, another question. Did you use Qiskit only or some other tools as well for developing the games? So we didn't develop the games.
We didn't develop any game. This was more of a literature of survey of the entire literature. So there's Qiskit blocks if anyone wants to try out, and a few more which uses Qiskit, but yeah. Okay, so do you believe that the game quantum will be recognized? Okay, so as far as I get this question, it's Paula wants to ask whether quantum games would be as common and frequent as normal classical games which one uses. So what I would say is all of these games, if you would have checked out their genre, they were arcade, but arcade in a sense was they were trying to explain a quantum mechanical phenomena in the first place. So yes, they can be used as most of the games in the list could be used as games to explain some quantum mechanical phenomena. So yes, they can be definitely used in the educational part. That's all that I can say. How close do you think?
Also, Mayu wants to say something regarding that question, and we will actually discuss that question in the panel as well, but we can start by right now giving some answers to Paula.
Okay.
Milo?
Oh, yeah. Many thanks to Anna Maria and Anand for the very interesting presentation. So I have a question for Anna Maria. So whether in particular in fact it is also a question for Anand, and maybe as Zeki was suggesting we can also discuss later on in the panel, but just for now, just introduce the point. Do you plan think about games, quantum games that can be used at any age? And by any age, I mean very young and not so many, so not so young ages. So the kind of the type of ages that are not in, I think, in the mainstream of those who usually are involved in games.
Well, that maybe connects with something that we could discuss. That is, what does it mean to have a quantum game, right?
A like quantum game, absolutely, a quantum game.
Quantum, yeah. So maybe it's the concepts, or is the use like of quantum random numbers in our test. So mm-hmm. I think that I didn't see like any game specifically to join people, but I think it could be developed maybe for the intuition, as we call it. So yeah, I think that maybe it's a developing part that we could discuss. Yeah, I don't know if Sophie and Anan, how do they think about this?
So I would take on the question with so the age is important, but honestly, what does the game want to represent? Like, is it trying, what the game is trying to explain, what the game aims at also matters. So yes,
of course. I'm sorry if I interrupt you, Anant. Of course, I was especially thinking to educational purposes.
Okay, so as long as it's educational purposes, well, if a kid, I would be happy to listen to some 7-year-old who wants to learn quantum. Mm-hmm. So if he wants to, yes, definitely there are games which can, you know, explain it in the first place quite easily. Games can be used for the age. Yes, age wouldn't be a barrier, because games are just games. As long as, you know, you just read the rules and do stuff around. And at the end, if someone ends up learning something new, well, that's good for the person who developed it and for the user too.
Yeah,
and I think there maybe are some games that young people could play. It's not like there are for older people. It's just I'm going maybe to show you later. It's a game that is moving. Is moving, like moving a character, and like later game I mentioned, like Beachbody Daddy, is moving. The general character and eating the little monsters and copying their features. But maybe with the question is about the game that use the concepts, and about that we could discuss in a little while. One of the papers that we had, that is like the design challenges for science games and vision motivation and memorization. But we could discuss it later if you want. Okay.
Okay. I think we answered most of the questions, and we can continue answering them in our panel. Do you have anything to add, Anna Maria, Anand?
No, that's all. Thank you for being such a good audience.
Okay, and thank you for your presentations. Okay, this time we can slowly continue with our panel.